This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Hey, Marcus, how's with you here? Well, SpaceX did it. They stuck the landing beautifully here with Starship Number 15. We will, of course, be diving into this along with all of the updates at Starbase. It is time to chat a little about the human landing system protests that have suspended SpaceX's funding for the Lunar Mission. We had the beautiful conclusion to the Crew 1 mission for the Commercial Crew program, a few updates from our robotic friends on Mars, and another terrific Starlink launch, yet another action-packed week. So here we are talking again about Starship Number 15, the next prototype by SpaceX that was to take to the sky. Last week we were all geared up for the flight, just awaiting weather delays. Well, this week frustratingly kicked off in a similar fashion. SpaceX scrubbed SN15's launch attempt on Tuesday due to high winds, which were causing concern for operations that would occur post-launch. The crew, after a successful touchdown, need to secure that vehicle, but if winds are too high, it could have endangered the team taking on that important role, so no flight that day. That all changed, however, at 5:24 p.m. on Wednesday afternoon. History has been made this week with an incredibly exciting launch. The ignition and gigantic plume of exhaust and dust was seen here as the event kicked off. The entire community thrilled to see this next iteration of the Starship fly. The latest Starship prototype, SN15, gracefully lifted off the launch stand and rode the pillar of fire with those three Raptor engines flawlessly hurling the vehicle into the Texas sky. The official SpaceX livestream, although rather choppy, was the best source of footage for this incredible flight. Sadly, due to the thick cloud cover, livestreamers on the ground were unable to see much of the majority of the flight. As Starship ascended, SpaceX provided us with this new incredible view straight from one of the forward flaps. One engine was shut down, followed soon by the second. Once it reached its maximum altitude of 10 kilometers, it hovered for a short time, completing a tank handoff where the Raptor engine's source of propellant is transferred from the main tanks to the heady tanks, ready for that flip maneuver. At 4 minutes and 20 seconds, the aerosurfaces started maneuvering into position to transition the vehicle into that horizontal skydive position to complete the subsonic portion of the flight. Those aft and forward fins are then utilized to hold the vehicle stability for a controlled descent back to the landing site. Now, this was the moment where the entire community was hoping for a successful landing after those past four explosions, and there it is. As Starship approached the landing pad, two Raptors fired up successfully to bring SN15 upright and continued down under those same two Raptor engines for the final descent. The six tiny legs popped out and locked into position, and there we saw history being made with SN15's soft touchdown. Importantly as well, the Raptors on SN15 have stayed on since the beginning of testing and have not needed to be replaced after performing two perfect static fires. SN15 lifted off first try with no aborts, and it relit perfectly and landed smoothly. That is a significant improvement on all other flights. The heat shield tiles also look to have survived quite well with only one missing. There are more improvements to this to be had, I'm sure, but they certainly seem to be improving the reliability over time. I think we just need to appreciate with this one how smoothly this vehicle has proceeded through to its launch campaign. Huge congratulations to all of those workers at SpaceX, NASA, and the FAA who made this flight a success. Once on the ground, SN15 was depressurized, safed, and cleared to start securing operations. This was a moment that will go down in history. Multiple prototypes and test tanks have brought us to this point where we see a complete Starship vehicle right there standing on its own. It's flown to 10 kilometers, belly flopping back to the landing site, where it then flipped back to vertical and touched down successfully. A truly remarkable event this was. It has been so exciting and inspiring to watch SpaceX iterate for the past year. Since the flight, SpaceX have raised the vehicle up and rolled the transporter underneath, followed by removing the legs. Elon Musk tweeted soon after, reminding everybody that public support for life on Mars is critical to making it happen, also hinting that they may try to refly fly SN15 soon. Saying that, just keep in mind that this was also suggested for SN5 and 6. In the end, rapid iteration means that SN15 is already obsolete. With this victory, I'm speculating that we will see real focus to push towards an orbital flight with Starship Number 20 and the first booster. With Elon's focus to have orbital flights by July, other suborbital flights may just add further delays to that idea. Remember that closing down the site repeatedly for these flight tests interrupts development a great deal, especially at the launch site where a lot needs to be done to get ready for an orbital flight. After that, continued focus to allow an uncrewed flight to Mars by 2024 is going to be crucial. We have some exciting events ahead. A big thank you to Lab Padre for the support of our live stream of this event, and Tony Bella as well for joining us here to witness this with you all live. I just love this stuff, and we cover this in depth every Saturday, so if you want to keep up to date as well, you know what to do. Those subscribe buttons, like buttons, share buttons, they are all over the place. Thank you for your support. To news over at the build site while all of this has been going on, a common dome for BN2.1 that was spotted a few weeks back, and this we believed at the time would be a full-sized Super Heavy prototype. However, now with the ramp up of work on BN3 and the lack of parts spotted for BN2.1, as seen on Brendan's latest diagram, we believe that BN2.1 is now possibly just scrapped, and that BN3 will be the very first flight booster. That is pure speculation at this moment, and nothing is confirmed there, but we did see booster number 3's afterdome section flipped during the week. Last week, part of SN20's thrust dome was spotted, and along with this we believe that this newly delivered thrust puck is also for SN20. This here features a different design to the previous pucks, as it looks like they've moved the bellows joint, which used to be attached to the upper part of the downcomer. It now looks like it comes with the puck itself. For those that don't know what a bellows joint is, it's a flexible element to compensate for dimensional changes caused by expansion or contraction of the downcomer due to the extreme thermal changes. It is unknown why it was moved to the opposite end of the downcomer, but it's just an interesting observation as SN20 is planned to be the first orbital prototype. This new thrust pack also has some minor mass reduction cutoffs on the Raptor mounting plates. Furthermore, we believe this three-ring high section here is SN20's thrust dome sleeve, and thanks very much, as always, to the amazing Boca Chica Gal and NASA spaceflight for spotting so many of these great sights. No label has been spotted by Mary to confirm this, but the bracing matches the same height and the proportions to the previous thrust sleeves. The hole cutouts are on the middle ring matching previous thrust sleeves, and you can see at least two areas where bracing does not cover. Judging by the distance there, the three of these gaps in the bracing would match with the Raptor vacuum engine placement. The third ground support equipment, or GSE tank, for the orbital launch pad has now been fully stacked as well. This tank is two rings shorter than the previous two GSE tanks, and that is because we believe that this third tank will hold liquid methane. Along with this, the forward and after domes for the fourth GSE tank are now sleeved as well. So yes, there was certainly plenty of work going on outside SN15's launch. Now, unless you've been living under a rock, you would have heard the news a few weeks ago about SpaceX being picked by NASA to build the next human lunar lander. Quite soon after, though, Blue Origin submitted a protest around NASA's decision that awarded SpaceX with almost $3 billion for that lunar Starship plan. But it wasn't quite so well known that Dynetics also filed a protest. Since these protests came in, NASA's funding for SpaceX has, for the moment at least, been suspended. That is obviously disappointing for SpaceX that is wanting to achieve this epic milestone, but as far as I've seen from reading into some of this material, there are some interesting arguments. We'll dive more into the arguments in just a moment, but first, a big thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. Skillshare is a huge online learning community made up of thousands of curious people. You can find almost any creative subject that you're interested in, and before you know it, there you are increasing your skills and getting a deeper knowledge of related skills that you didn't even know that you were missing. Your interests may lie in website development, it could be in animation or video production, you name it. Last year I spent some time learning a little After Effects, but more recently I wanted to get a little deeper into some of the more advanced techniques. In this course, Jake Bartlett teaches us how to take the next steps as an animator and unleash the power of the After Effects graph editor. This demonstrates very nicely how to learn everything you need to know about how to take full control of your motion on screen. Even if you've been using After Effects for years, or if you've just started learning the program, this class is easy to follow and it will really show you the full power of easing with the motion you create. Skillshare is organized specifically for learning with no ads interrupting you, and it's also incredibly affordable at less than $10 a month with an annual subscription. If you'd like to help support me and you'd like to give it a try, the first 1,000 of my subscribers to click the link in the description will get 30% off the annual premium membership so you can explore your creativity. Even if you've already had a free trial of Skillshare, you can still take advantage of this offer to get a full year of unlimited learning and creative exploration. Just follow the link there in the description below. So yes, in the file protest by Dynetics, they argued that NASA had subsequently chosen the most anti-competitive and high-risk option available with the award decision to SpaceX's Lunar Starship. Blue Origin also argued that NASA had simply moved the targets at the last minute, which adds extra pressure to an already very tight timeline aiming to get humans back to the lunar surface in 2024. Here is the thing though, NASA's choice to pick just one provider was, I suspect, the only option that NASA had. Currently, Congress had only made available an extremely limited budget, with it being reported that so far NASA have received only $850 million out of the requested $3.3 billion needed for two separate lunar landers. This also isn't to say that further budget is not going to open up, but for now they only have funding for this one option. Now, having a little bit of a read over the protest document by Dynetics, there are certainly fair arguments from their point of view. When NASA made the initial HLS contract award in April 2020, NASA explained that its acquisition strategy would allow NASA to realize the benefits of competition when selecting the award of the Human Landing System contract options. They stated that maintaining this competitive environment through the 2024 demonstrations and beyond was essentially to create performance and pricing incentives for HLS contractors. Now, because the budget only currently seems to exist for one, the strategy they based their plan on was not valid. So yes, although the funding has at this time been suspended for SpaceX, they will still, I think, have that continue in the near future. More than likely, it is best to look at the current award as that first initial step for the program. We should, I think, see more award opportunities pop up for other contractors soon, and as with all things political, there are many steps to take to acquire the necessary funding for a colossal moon mission. Now, last week we talked about the arrival of Crew 2 to the International Space Station and the imminent departure and re-entry of Crew 1, which was soon going to follow as our last video went live. This was the incredible conclusion to the very first operational mission of Crew Dragon and the commercial crew program. As expected, Crew Dragon Resilience undocked from the Harmony module at 8:35 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time and began its journey home. Following a final weather evaluation, Resilience jettisoned its trunk, performed a 16-minute deorbit burn, closed its nose cone, and prepared for its fiery entry into the atmosphere. The amazing Michael, Victor, Soichi, and Shannon were all strapped in for the final nail-biting plunge into the atmosphere at over 27,600 kilometers per hour. This is always an extremely stressful part of the mission, and of course the most dangerous. If any of the systems involved in the safe recovery fail, it would be a disaster. That is why there is so much testing with these vehicles to ensure that any foreseeable risks are mitigated. It's also why there are so many delays during the development of vehicles such as Crew Dragon, and why we are yet to see Boeing's Starliner fly with crew. This is serious business. The four chutes we see here all opened up as expected, and there we see Resilience and its crew of astronauts splash down into the Gulf of Mexico at 2:56 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Shortly after, they were recovered by the Dragon 2 recovery vessel, Go Navigator. Now, I think think there are some interesting points to this recovery. Point one is that this was the first splashdown occurring at night by NASA since Apollo 8 in December 1968. Secondly, and I think this is even more interesting, is that this Crew 1 mission was the longest American crewed spaceflight mission, overtaking the record set by the final Skylab mission in 1974. That is an amazing effort by the entire team. The recovery of this mission to me seemed super smooth as well, compared with Demo 2, which was delayed by elevated levels of hypergolic fuels used in the propulsion system, and all of those pesky private boats in the recovery zone. The recovery of Crew 1 was comparatively non-eventful. The astronauts exited resilience with the assistance of recovery crews aboard Go Navigator, and they were evaluated before flying via helicopter to Houston. This was a colossal milestone for both SpaceX and NASA, and congratulations to all of you involved in this incredible mission. On Tuesday, as Star Wars fans around the globe celebrated May the 4th, SpaceX launched their latest batch of Starlink satellites from historic Launch Complex 39A. This booster began its life on the Telstar 18V mission in September of 2018, before making a trip out west and launching the Iridium 8 mission from Vandenberg Air Force Base. Since then, it has supported 7 Starlink missions from Florida and picked up thousands of frequent flyer miles. Liftoff here took place at 3:01 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, and following that, of course, stage separation 2 minutes and 35 seconds after liftoff. The first stage began its journey back to Earth, first lighting 3 of its Merlin 1D engines to shed velocity for the intense heat of re-entry. Following that came the landing burn of one Merlin engine to come to a graceful stop on the deck of the drone ship, Of Course I Still Love You, 633 kilometers from where it started. Quite the bullseye there, perfectly dead center. We were once again lucky enough to have stunning views from the booster throughout re-entry and landing. It's just incredible to have a front row seat to the booster falling through the air, controlling itself with its grid fins, and then landing on the drone ship, which first appears to be so small in that vast ocean. These booster landings have become routine for SpaceX, but are still an incredible and exciting feat to watch each and every time. There we go, right there, this ninth landing for this booster, which is now tied with booster 1051. We should be witnessing the next record breaker soon, with one of these two boosters flying for the 10th time. 1 hour and 4 minutes into the mission, there we see the deployment as well of the 60 Starlink satellites, this time shimmering in the light there with the sun very low on the horizon. The goal of accessible high-speed internet for all is getting closer with each Starlink mission, thanks in no small part to the incredible reusability of the Falcon 9 booster. Interestingly, SpaceX's Starlink has now apparently received more than 500,000 orders so far, which is quite amazing as well. What was once considered impossible is now enabling the largest satellite constellation to grow at an unbelievable pace. Now, it has been great following the success of the Mars Ingenuity helicopter the past few weeks. It seems that this success has morphed now into this little helicopter going from a month of technology demonstration activities to actual support demonstration duties for the Perseverance rover. The plan is that once Ingenuity completes its flight demonstrations shortly, as a bonus, it's now going to fly ahead of Perseverance to look for hazards and potential sites for sediment and rock sampling. The idea, of course, being how much value can aerial scouting assist the operations of a rover such as Perseverance. The helicopter can gather intel on the path forward and sites of interest while the rover is dedicated to science gathering activities. The plans just recently changed when it was decided not to drive Perseverance away from the landing site, leaving Ingenuity behind entirely. Thanks to a site of interest in the area, they will both work together to gather as much science as possible before the middle of October. This is the time when the Earth and Mars are at opposite sides of the Sun, making communications impossible for a period of time. So yes, with flight time now extended by a month, anything beyond that now all depends on the solar-powered heater holding out. It was only built to last for 1 month, so protecting Ingenuity from the freezing night temperatures is going to be an interesting challenge. Still, it's great to see how NASA can change plans like this as the mission evolves. We hope to see Ingenuity last for a bit longer yet. There is a lot of data to recover, which will provide wonderful inspiration to assist in the design of future vehicles like this. So yes, certainly no shortage of news this week. Thanks as always for sticking through it all with us. Remember that we are huge supporters of the transition to electric vehicles here on the channel as well. And our partner EV offers the ability to hire an electric vehicle in Australia. Perhaps you have wanted to take an extended test drive. You could be touring the country and want to drive around in a Tesla. If that sounds appealing to you, you can use the link in the description for a discount. Thanks to our amazing patrons and YouTube members as well. Your support contributes significantly to the frequency and the quality of these uploads, and it also allows us to increase the time that we can collectively spend in research, editing, and quality control. Thank you to each and every one of you. If you like what we're doing and you'd like to help support what we do, you can join as a YouTube member via the join button below, or you can become a patron at patreon.com/MarcusHouse. Either of those options gives you access to chat with us more directly via the linked roles on our Discord server. You can also have your name listed right here like all these other incredible people, and you also get earlier and ad-free access to the videos to watch before anyone else. Massive thank you especially to the production crew assisting greatly with video production, along with the quality control squad for helping me research and proof the material for these videos. If you're interested in these topics and you would like to keep up to date, remember to subscribe here below and follow me on Twitter at MarcusHouse. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video from last week. In the top right is my latest video, and in the bottom right, content that YouTubers selected from my channel just for you. Thank you everyone for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.